minds, perspectives, people with diabetes and those who were visiting diabetic retinopathy clinics or retina clinics in the different parts of the country. We then shared those results in 2014 at the DR Summit, which was held here in Hyderabad, and which led to the formation of a DR task force, just like the formation of an ROP task force in 2013. Around this time, there was also a revamping of the National Task Force for ROP, where there was an understanding that neither ROP nor diabetic retinopathy could be viewed as purely ophthalmic problems, and we needed to have an integrated approach. If either of these two emerging causes of visual impairment in our part of the world is to be tackled. Immediately after the DR summit, in fact, it was during the DR summit that Claire and me, with the help of Sally Crook from IAPB, who put together the proposal for DR, of the grant proposal for DR, that was during the summit. I remember working a couple of hours later than what I normally do to see that that grant application was submitted. And we had the grant for DR in November 2014, following on for the grant for ROP, which is July 2014. But if you look at what actually happened from 2014 to 2015 in relation to ROP, and from 2014 till 2016 January in relation to DR, we were actually getting the state governments on board, building up the consensus amongst the state governments to partner and implement these two initiatives. What we felt was that was critical for the success was an ownership of the state governments. And therefore, we invested a lot of time in getting the state governments on board along with the mentoring institutions before we actually started the physical implementation of projects. And looking back, I think that was a great step that we embarked upon to try and build consensus and build ownership, because this, at the end of the day, not only is it a Commonwealth asset, it is also the country's asset and the various state governments who have actually implemented this project. In 2016 July, we had one more infusion of funds specifically to look at type 1 diabetes, and Professor Nikhil would be talking to us, and Dr. Raj Lakshmi and Dr. Vishwanath and Kiran Mayer later on. But this was an add-on to the originally planned integrated approach making a difference to health systems with diabetic retinopathy. This was more of a clinic-based approach, and this started in 2016. In 2017, we had a midterm assessment, which was conducted by a professional group, AMILTAS, and we'll have Dr. Sunita, who would share with us what she has now been doing in relation to putting up the end-term evaluation, which is currently being compiled. She has visited a large number of partners, spoken to many more, and is now ready with the draft report. So this actually essays the journey over the last 6 years as to what has happened in the country. This midterm assessment was very, very critical. It actually acted like a mirror, which was held up to us, to let us know what the gaps were, where we had not done as well as expected, and where we needed to have some mid-course corrections, which were then incorporated into the program and allowed the program to go to June 2019 on a successful path. And here we have Andrew showing us the flag of the end of the journey. Just like in a Formula One race, it was no less than a Formula One race that we all went through in the last 6 years. I just hope that the flag can go back a bit more into the future, but I know that that is not possible at the moment. talking about the time that it took initially, so though we had signed the agreement for the grant in July 2014, the first state where the ROP project started was Telangana. That was in December 2015. We added Madhya Pradesh by June 2016, and it was finally functional in all the four states, including Odisha and Maharashtra, in December 2016. So, though it was 2014, it took us a year and a half to actually have the systems in place to be able to make a meaningful difference and to have something tangible as the outcome which we would be looking at today. When I look at the DR project, though we signed the agreement in November 2014 when the grant actually came in, it was only in June 2016, a clear 18 to 20 months later, that we had the first activity started. That was in Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh, the first two states. Then we scaled up to 5 by December 2016. To 9 by June 2017, and the last state, which the last two states were Gujarat and West Bengal, where in terms of Gujarat, the agreement with the Gujarat government happened late, and then West Bengal, though the agreement happened, it took a lot of time in West Bengal to get it off the ground. So it was only December 2017 that we had all the 10 states on a functional note. So even though it's a six-year journey, if you look at the points, time points that I'm mentioning, some states have had less time in implementation mode compared to other states. Like I said, this is your success. This is a celebration where there is no bridegroom, there is no bride. We're all the Baratis. We're all there to enjoy. We will dance, sing, and enjoy ourselves, because of the great efforts that all of you have put in to make this program, this pilot project, so successful. It was the NGO mentoring partners and the government sector, starting with the National Health Mission, the NPCDCS, the National Program for Control of Blindness and Visual Impairment, UNICEF in relation to the ROP program, and all the other partners, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, PGI Chandigarh, Government Medical College Chandigarh, Goa Medical College, and all the other state governments who actually came forward to actually be a partner in this initiative. So thanks to all of you for making this a memorable journey. Andrew has just mentioned about the Countess of Essex. Her Highness visited us in April this year. She came to Hyderabad to look at the work that was done under the project, and specifically looked at how the public hospitals, the public health system was actually strengthened. So we had the Countess visit Gandhi Medical College and the Niloufar Hospital, as well as visit the mentoring partner under Dr. Subhadra Jalali's guidance at the L.V. Prasad Eye Institute. So she was actually amazed to see the progress that the project had made, and we were so happy to see her so happy and contented interacting with children and their families as part of the visit. So thank you all for a memorable journey, and hope we can continue a consortium spirit for many other activities in the future. Thank you.
And now I'd like to request Dr. G. N. Rao to come and present the inaugural address.
Congratulate Dr. Murthy, Dr. Gilbert, the entire group of Queen Elizabeth Diamond Jubilee Trust for this outstanding program that has made already a big difference in India and is going to make a much bigger difference in the years to come by. Yesterday morning, my secretary came into my office and said, the son of a friend of ours was in the clinic and he wanted to see me. So then he came to meet me. But the pleasant surprise was he came along with his wife and his 4-month-old twins. I came to know from them that they were premature born. But he came to meet me for 2 reasons. One is to introduce his children to me. And the second was to thank me for the system that was created to screen the premature kids in the maternal and child hospital that they were cared by. And he said multiple times they were screened, and it is because of that kind of care that their children were guaranteed that they would not have any problem with ROP. So after that experience, and when GVS asked me to come and speak here today, I was reminded of the late 90s, when the concept of Vision 2020, the right to sight, was being addressed. A small group of us used to meet in Geneva. And then Claire was, I think, still a teenager probably at that time. And so we discussed about all the major causes, how to put the program together, etc., etc. While we knew the problems like cataract already had proven and cost-effective treatments, there was always this dilemma about how to deal with the big problem of diabetic retinopathy and blindness in children. From that start to what is happening today, it's been an incredible journey. In the evolution of Vision 2020, the right to sight, I think the two major non-governmental players that have made a difference through infusion of significant funding was the $100 million support that came from Standard Chartered Seeing is Believing program, and then the £100 million infusion from the Queen Elizabeth Diamond Jubilee Trust. I want to congratulate Andrew and his group at Queen Elizabeth for such a fantastic achievement in the area of trachoma in accelerating the march towards complete elimination of that problem from the face of our earth in the not too distant future. While India is not affected by it and not part of it, we should certainly join the global celebration. In India, we have been fortunate to get the support for the two areas that are very important and critical for us: diabetic retinopathy in the elderly and ROP in the newborns. I think it did 3 things for us. One is it has helped to initiate in some areas, to enhance in some areas, and to accelerate in some other areas these two programs on diabetic retinopathy and retinopathy of prematurity. The second achievement, in my view, is the successful partnership that this program could pull together from across the country of diverse group from all sectors, government, non-governmental, not-for-profit, and then private sectors. And that's not easy. So for that, I would like to congratulate GBS for using his personal charm in ample measure to bring all the players to one table. And I think that resulted in all the progress that has been made over the past 4 or 5 years. And the third one is looking into the future. I think there are two challenges. One is how do we sustain this momentum that is created by the significant infusion of funding? Is our government ready? Is our non-governmental sector ready? Can this partnership be sustained? So these are questions that we have to address, and I sincerely hope that the momentum not only can be sustained, but also can be made even faster to reach our goals of creating a framework for the entire country to tackle the problems of diabetic retinopathy and ROP in future. The second is the continuing challenge of capacity building in this area in all the sectors. And I think this program has already started that. And the third one, also in this aspect that we have to look at, is the standards that have been arrived at should be maintained in future with periodic reassessment and obviously upgradation. So overall, I'm delighted to see this significant progress made and India taking the lead. And I want to congratulate all the partners, all the people who played a pivotal role in making this program such a success in our country. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rao. Now I'd like to request Dr. Nikhil Tandon to come and give us the inaugural address, sorry, the President's address.
Thank you and good morning, everybody. At some point I will ask GB what I was made President of, but we'll tackle that later. It is really a privilege to be here today in the presence of all of you, very eminent professionals, on the occasion of this dissemination summit. Much has been said about the project, its genesis, its funding, the journey so far, and much has been said by people far more competent than I am to say. And so I will restrict myself to something I know a little about, which is diabetic retinopathy, and more specifically, the challenge of bringing complementarity between two disciplines, ophthalmology on the one hand and endocrinology, diabetology on the other, to work towards what I think is an aspirational but achievable target of eliminating this vision-threatening disease. So obviously tackling blindness has been central to the work of ophthalmology, not only as individual practitioners, but to the system itself. And the National Program for the Control of Blindness in its initial efforts concentrated on what it should have really, which was cataract blindness. And I think with a slew of campaigns, coalitions, and the concerted efforts of governmental, civil society, and private organizations, made a very significant and creditable impact on the problem of cataract blindness. And I think it is time now to put the same zeal, fervor, enthusiasm, and energy into doing a program for diabetic retinopathy. But at this point, I must draw attention to the fact that there are a few fundamental differences in that. And the same would, I assume, apply in equal measure to retinopathy of prematurity. Firstly, patients with cataract-associated blindness or diminution of vision will seek out ophthalmic consults, will seek out assistance because they have clearly vision-related symptoms. In comparison, patients with diabetic retinopathy will not actually seek medical attention at all till it is very late or too late to do anything meaningfully effective. Secondly, ophthalmology as a discipline can, on its own, manage the problem of cataract blindness and manage it very, very effectively. They actually need no help from the other constituents of the medical fraternity. Diabetes care, and I expand from diabetic retinopathy to diabetes care, on the other hand, is constrained by access to and affordability of healthcare, and I must confess, embarrassedly here, inefficient, ineffective, and a fragmented healthcare delivery. Therefore, making a programmatic solution for diabetic retinopathy is an absolutely different story altogether from, let's say, cataract blindness. Screening, therefore, is imperative, it is critical, because as I just said, the problem of diabetic retinopathy can evolve without the appearance of visual symptoms, so it is really too late to intervene meaningfully. This means we need to screen early, screen periodically, and screen efficiently. And the solution to the problem, therefore, cannot be with the ophthalmologist alone. While manifest disease, for example, diabetic macular edema, proliferative diabetic retinopathy, vitreous hemorrhage, clearly need the expert skills and interventions of ophthalmologists. But the metabolic management, which really underpins the development and evolution of retinopathy, control of glucose, control of lipids, control of blood pressure, is very clearly in the therapeutic domain of the endocrinologist, diabetologist. The challenge, therefore, of interdisciplinary collaboration needs to be met. And the synergy needs to be established to ensure that optimal delivery of care for the patient is actually achieved. And this is a very, very big mountain to climb. So there are three issues in this journey. First, essentially, you've got to bring somebody thirsty to the well where there's water. But that has to be broken down into its constituent parts. Here's a person who is thirsty who doesn't realize that he or she is thirsty, right? They don't think they need to go to the well. We're not sure that there's enough water in the well everywhere. We heard Dr. Rao talk about capacity building. And even if you manage to take the unwilling thirsty to a well with water, it sometimes isn't enough to ensure they get treated. And therefore, these are the three procedural challenges that we really need to meet. And the first hurdle, and the one which we need to address very, very promptly, is to enable screening. Screening must become a habit. It has to become ingrained in the standard practice norms of every physician looking after a person with diabetes. It must be incumbent on the physician to ensure that the patient understands the gravity of the disease, the essentiality of getting screened, and the need to seek and obtain appropriate therapy, both for their primary disease, and if unfortunately that they do develop retinopathy, for their eye disease. All this is easier said than done, but it must be done. And it cannot be done at the level of the individual healthcare provider or the individual hospital. It has to be done at the level of the health system. It has to be integrated within the compendium of care for a person with diabetes, a critical part of this holistic model. The government of India, through the National Program for the Prevention and Control of Cancer, Diabetes, CVD, and Stroke, and the National Health Mission, has taken a decision to offer universal screening for five conditions, namely diabetes, hypertension, and three common cancers. Linked with this are various digital health initiatives, both at the state level, which several states have taken on their own, including Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, and through